We open each service with these two affirmations or statements of belief. We call them the Shema and the Tova. In the Shema, we affirm that our God is the only true and living God. He is one God, eternally existent in three persons, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. The scripture reference for the Shema is found in Deuteronomy 6:4 and Mark 12:29. Our next affirmation is the Tova. In the Tova, we affirm that our name is sealed in the book of life forever. The scripture reference for the Tova is Exodus 32:33 and Revelation 3:5. It is customary for us to lift our hands toward the heavens when we recite our affirmations. We recite them twice in Hebrew and twice in English. I ask that you repeat after me. Shema, Israel, Adonai, Eloheinu, Adonai, Ehad. Shema, Israel, Adonai, Eloheinu, Adonai, Ehad. Hear, O Israel, the Lord, our God, is one Lord. Hear, O Israel, the Lord, our God, is one Lord. Gama Hatama Tova. Gama Hatama Tova. May your name be sealed in the book of life forever. May your name be sealed in the book of life forever.
Come on, say. too high. Yahweh, and we lift you high. Yahweh, Yahweh, and we lift you high. It's Yahweh, and we lift you high. You alone deserve my worship. You alone deserve my praise. And you alone deserve the honor.
Glory to God. Hallelujah. God is faithful and amazing. It's Yahweh, Yahweh, Yahweh. He's the only wise and living God, the mighty one. He's the perfect one. He's the everlasting one. He's El Elah Olam, the everlasting God. He's El Emunah, the faithful God. He is Yahweh. Yahweh is who he is. That's his name. And he's seated on the throne high above everything you can go through today and everything that's coming against your life. I want you to exalt him above everything that tries to come against you this week. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Go ahead and lift your hands and just shout Yahweh, Yahweh, Yahweh. He's a perfect, a mighty, and amazing, and awesome, wonderful God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. We thank God for who he is. Thank you for tuning in with us today. God is faithful. He's amazing, and he's mighty and awesome. If you throw a one up, we'll acknowledge you. All of our first timers, we want to say thank you for tuning in. And for all of you who are around the world, and definitely to all of my dominionaires and my dominion nation, we want to say hello. We love you. Hugs and kisses to you. Come on, can y'all give God praise for Pastor Regina as she danced so beautifully before the Lord? Hallelujah. Let's go to the throne room in prayer. Father, we thank you. We give you glory because you are Yahweh, because you are the one and only living God. You're consistent in all your ways, and we appreciate and thank you for who you are. We honor you. We thank you that this word will have the preeminence. We thank you for the glory and the grace that will rest upon them. Give your people illumination and enlightenment. In Jesus' mighty name, amen, amen. Wow, glory to God. Man, we are soaring right here on Yahweh in the movement, in the rhythm of who he is. Glory to God. Now, last week we started something. As we're in this new year on the Gregorian, on the Hebraic calendar called 5781, 5781. This is the year I call the year of the wonder, the year of the mark, the year that you're going to really be anointed by the Holy Ghost, and the year of wealth. I really sense that. I really sense that strong. And one of the things the Lord began to deal with me about is agreement. And so last week we started in our series called The Power of Agreement. And I thought I was finished, and the Lord says, do the part two. We're going to do a part two of The Power of Agreement, understanding the spiritual nuances of being in agreement with one or of an entity or being. And so I want to be careful how I say this. So let's get to the word of God before I get too fast. Y'all know me. Amen. Let's go to Matthew 18 and 19. The Bible says, again, I say unto you that if any two of you shall agree on earth concerning anything they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. Let's read it again. Bible says, again, I say to you that if two of you agree on earth concerning anything they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. Now, the Bible says that God is so gracious that whatever you ask, come on, in agreement with any being or entity in the earth, he said he'll grant it, good or bad. Good or bad. Now you're saying, Nesbitt, why is this? Because the power of agreement means that you come in symphonic, rhythmic movement and in the realm that God has called you. Now when we talk about agreement, the word agreement is symphono, where we get the word symphony from, where it means to be in agreement with, in unison, in a one accord, to speak with agreement, harmonious and united. It is to declare statements agreed upon, to champion the same vision, to agree on. It is to regard something settled, to reach an agreement. What does that mean? That means I totally, wholeheartedly agree with God in every area of my life, and I'll see the manifestation of the kingdom, that you come into agreement. And what we fail to realize, people of God, is That there are a lot of times that we come out of agreement with God. It's very subtle. Remember, the enemy operates on agreement and authority. He operates on agreement and authority. What am I saying? He operates on agreement that you get to agree with the lie. You agree with the lie that he tells you, that pulls you out of the agreement with the word of God. And then he holds you captive. He holds you in a cycle that keeps you in bondage. Somebody got to say hallelujah, amen, or something right there, because you're going to begin to see how the enemy has kept you isolated, kept you in hostage, in bondage to things you should have been free of. Though you pray, though you fast, though you give your offering and your tithe, he has lied to you. You have agreed with him, and he's taken your authority. He has taken your authority. What does that mean? That means, remember last week we said you've got to be impeccable with your words. You've got to be impeccable with your words, because the enemy will get you to start conceptualizing what he said. You plant that seed in your heart and you let that thing germinate, and it grows on the inside of you. And now you have given birth to something that is adversarial to your purpose and your destiny. Remember, we said that agreement is synergy. Agreement synergy is the working together of two things that produce a greater effect. A greater effect. It is the advantageous agreement that results in a greater outcome. That means the more I agree with God, the more I'm going to see this thing come to pass. Now, I said a person can be in agreement with a spirit, either good or bad, without even knowing it. It's simple things. It's simple things, body of Christ. Come on, people of God. It's the simple things that we do. Come on, I want to teach this so you can go back and regurgitate it and teach it to those who are around you, that you have come into agreement with principles, with powers, with laws that keep you subtly bound to some things. And once you agree with that, that spirit will create an atmosphere that prevails. Let's just say you've got this thing that you've agreed with, that you've got this anger problem, or you got this problem that you can't get over, and you seemingly need deliverance. Now, I'm not saying fun folk don't need deliverance hands laid on them, but I'm saying maybe 50-60% we think is the devil, is our faulty teaching, or because we have agreed with some being, some entity, and we've allowed the enemy to hold us captive. Now, there was a lady that came to me, and she said, I can't break this thing. Remember I told you the story? She couldn't break the spirit of poverty. Well, she agreed to that growing up, that she would be poor all her life. You know, just growing up in object poverty, you agree that this must be the life that you are going to have to live the rest of your life. Well, no devil could be cast out, because that was her belief system. She agreed with that. And even though we could have laid hands on her, there would have been no results, because we didn't change her belief system. That's why most people that win the lottery or have massive amounts of money, if you don't deal with their unbelief, if you don't deal with their belief system, they're going to repeat the pattern. And so we had to change her belief system. And when we changed her belief system, her life began to change. Glory to God. Come on, people of God. This is the season you're going to walk in total agreement with the word of God. Amos 3:3 says, how can two walk together unless they agreed? That means the enemy cannot, come on, influence you, oppress you, unless you have agreed. There's something you have agreed, and we're going to break that agreement today. I said we're going to break that agreement today. That power of agreement that you've made with entities, beings, come on, demonic spirits, and you've allowed your belief system to take you into places where you have been held hostage. Today, the thing is going to break in the name of Jesus. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, Let's go over to Job 31. Let's go to Job 31. Let's see what Job 31 says. And we're going to move over on to some things. Job 31, look at verse 1. I made a covenant with my eyes. What does he say? When then should I think upon a maid? He says, I dedicate. This is the Amplified. He says, I dedicated a covenant, an agreement to my eyes. How then could I look lustfully upon a girl? For what portion should I have from God above if I were lewd? And what inheritance from the Almighty? Glory to God. He says, I made an agreement with my eyes that I would not pervert or pollute. Oh. So that means you can make an agreement. You can make a covenant with your eyes. You can make a covenant. The Bible says you can make an agreement with your eyes. And the power of that agreement, that's why pornography is so demonic, is because the enemy gets you to make an agreement with your eyes. He gets you to make a pact with your eyes. And then the spirit of lust, the spirit of perversion, then comes alongside of you and start influencing your life. He creates a culture and an environment around you that because you made that covenant, come on, until you renege or renounce that covenant agreement, that spirit is always going to be antagonizing you. It's always going to be influencing you and opening opportunities for you to keep watching and keep that covenant alive in your life. What am I saying? You know, when you got an anointing, it feels easy. Don't you know the enemy can give you an anointing to do bad? You know, sometimes when you're doing things outside of the kingdom, it seems like it's God, because things just fall into place. And people, that's how people get in trouble, because they would say it was so easy. It was like God was sanctioning and okaying it, when God was saying, I can't help you because you made covenant. And if two agree on the earth as touching anything, it will be done unto you. That's a spiritual law. And the enemy is a legalist. God is not a legalist, but the enemy is. And he knows when he can catch you in bondage. He can grab you when you make covenant. Then he opens the door for that thing you made covenant with to antagonize you and put you at a disadvantage instead of an advantage. Remember, we talked about Nimrod, how Nimrod caused God to come down because they all agreed. They all agreed. Everything in your house shall agree. The Bible says in Genesis 1:11, he says, and they were one language and one speech, that everybody was saying the same thing, that the whole nation that Nimrod was leading said the same thing. And the Bible says it caused God to come down. God came down. God came down. Glory to God. He came down because they were all in one accord. And he says nothing they imagine to do will be restrained. Nothing they imagine to do. They were so in one accord. They tapped into a principle where now the laws that govern the spirit realm was open up to them. And I really believe technology was released to them, because the Bible says nothing they imagine to do was withheld from them. And God says, I've got to do something. I've got to stop them, because they're going to build the tower that reached the heavens. He says, I've got to do something. And the Bible says he confound their language. So that tells me your language will cause God to come on the scene. That if you get in one accord, that God will come on the scene. I feel like running here. I said, when you get on one accord and when you have the rhythmic flow that causes God to come down by your unity, where you're getting your spirit, your soul, and your body in unity, that there is no divisiveness, that you're not divided. The Bible says, how can a kingdom stand if it's divided? How can a kingdom stand if it's divided? How can a marriage stand if it's divided? How can a family stand if it's divided? How can your finances stand the test of time if it's divided? If one day you believe that God is your shepherd and you shall not lack, and the next day you think the government owe you something and you can't get past because of your skin color, because of your gender, and because you are sitting there wondering, when is my time? No, no, no. You've got to, you've got to remove doubt and fear, and you got to put your trust back in God and say, God, come hell or high water, I'm standing on the word, and I will not shrink back, I will not look back, and I'm not going back to my faulty system, but I'm going to upgrade my belief system, and I'm going to agree with your word that death and life is in the power of my tongue, and when I speak, things begin to happen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. You got to get to the posture and the place where you're saying, I've got to come out of agreement. I've got to come out of agreement. I've got to come out of agreement with that. I can't agree with that. I cannot agree. The Bible says that Job made an agreement or covenant with his eyes. So if you can make a covenant with your eyes, you can make a covenant with your heart. You can make a covenant with your ears. You can make a covenant, come on, with your hands. That's why he says, bind the word on your hands, because you can put your hands to unclean things and you keep putting it to unclean things and you make a covenant with your hands. Somebody said, no. What am I saying? You remember in the Old Testament, the man of God placed his hands on Esau and place his hands on Jacob. And the Bible says by the laying on of his hands, he blessed them. He blessed them. Now, let's look at Mark. Mark 16. Let's look at Mark 16. Let me show you by covenant with your hands. Some of you can never prosper because your hands have come into agreement with some being or entity. Let's look at Mark 16. Look what he says. He says in verse 15, go in all the world, preach the gospel. He that believe and baptized shall be saved, and he that believe not shall be damned, and these signs shall follow them, and these signs shall follow them, and these signs shall follow them. What agreement? What agreement has been broken that signs don't follow you? What do you believe that caused the signs not follow you? Because the Bible says if you agree with him on this word, that it shall be done. So somewhere in your belief system, I don't know how it got stopped here. In your belief system, I hear the Holy Ghost. In your belief system, you don't believe signs shall follow you. For some reason, you believe you didn't pray enough, you didn't fast enough, you didn't hear long enough, you didn't hear. Whatever faulty belief system you have, he says, If you agree, the Amplified says, he who believes, adheres to, and trusts in, and rely on the gospel, and in him who have sent him forth, glory to God, he says, and is baptized, will be saved from the penalty of eternal death. But he who do not believe, who does not adhere, trust, or rely on the gospel, and him who sets it forth, will be condemned. And these attesting signs will accompany those who believe in my name. Wow. Nesbitt, I believe, but I don't believe is for today. Well, my church doesn't believe in this. Well, I've got a hard time believing that I can do that. Do you see? You have come into agreement. The enemy has supplanted a lie. You have come into agreement with that lie. And now he has taken your authority. And it looks like Satan's kingdom has power and authority. And it does. It's the power and the authority that he's received and stolen from the body of Christ because of our faulty belief systems and because we agreed that there is no power in the church and that we are powerless. He says, in my name they shall cast out devils. You got to see where you believe. Do you agree with that? Do you agree? Well, that's for the deliverance team. Wow. They shall speak with new tongues. I haven't tarried long enough for tongues. I don't think it take all of that. I'm finding you where you are. Look what he says. They shall take up serpents accidentally, not on purpose. Come on. And if they drink any deadly thing accidentally, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands. This is where I want to go. They shall lay clean hands. Come on. They shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. They shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. Oh, oh. And the Bible says, look what he says. Verse 20. And they went forth preaching everywhere, and the Lord working, what? Working signs with them. Working signs, confirming the word with signs following. He says, if you believe this, I'm going to confirm it. We're going to get into agreement, and I'm going to confirm what you believe. Wow. Wow. Glory to God. Hallelujah. 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 Let's go to Daniel. Let's go to Daniel. Let's go over to 2 Corinthians. Since we're here in the New Testament, let's go to 2 Corinthians 6 and 16. 2 Corinthians 6 and 16. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Look what he says. Let's look at verse 14. That's good. Come on, roll with me. I'm almost there. He says, be not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. Wow. He says, don't be yoked to unbelievers. Don't misalign your alliances. What is he saying? He says, look, because if you are yoked together with an unbeliever, it's going to change your ability to believe and to trust and agree with God. That's why in the Old Testament, you always saw God tell him, don't take wives of the pagans. Don't be yoked with the pagans. That's why he told David, kill everything. He told Saul, kill everything. Don't keep anything. Don't keep the fatted calf. Don't keep any of their wealth, any of their goods, because they have come in agreement with curses and that thing will get upon you. And Samuel had to come on, rebuke Saul, because Saul kept the things. He said, what is this lowing of sheep and the bleeding of sheep that I hear? He says, because you have done this, you've caused a breach in the spirit, and because that breach is in the spirit, the whole nation is going to come under judgment. What am I telling you? He says, don't be unequally yoked. There's some people that you're going to have to get rid of in your spirit of influence. Maybe that's not a good way to say it, get rid of, but you're going to have to walk in a season with folk that agree the way you agree with God, with the word of God. What is he saying? Don't be unequally yoked together with unbelievers. Now, unbelievers don't mean that they're not saved, because you can have people who say they are saved, but they're unbelievers. They're unbelievers. If you're believing for your healing and you got people around you who are fighting you about your healing, he said, don't be yoked to them. He said, don't be yoked to them, because what happens? Their unbelief is going to rub off on you and you're going to miss the mark in God. He says, for what fellowship have righteousness with what? Unrighteousness. And what communion have what? Light with darkness. He says you can't mix the two. You're going to either go to one side. You're going to either go to the righteous side or you're going to go to the unrighteous side. He says don't make no agreement with unbelievers. I have people all the time tell me, I'm just hanging out. And I say, well, they don't go to church. They're unbelievers. They're not trying to get saved. You just came out of a season of weakness, and you're now hanging back with them. And oh, I'm strong enough. I'm strong enough, Pastor. I'm strong enough that I can handle it. And in about 3 months, they've gone back to the other side. Why? They never broke agreement. They never broke agreement. And even in the midst of people saying, I'm coming to God, you still have to break agreement that you made with that spirit, with that entity, with that unbelieving system that's on the inside of you that is adversarial to God. Verse 15, and what concord have Christ with Belial? And what part have he that believed with an infidel? And what agreement? And what agreement? And what agreement, say Levanto, and what agreement have the temple of God with idols? What agreement? He's saying, what is the agreement? Come on, what is the agreement? How can you say you stand in the temple of God? You are the temple of God. Some of you don't even agree that you are the temple of the Holy Ghost. The Bible says that he dwells in you, that you're his habitation, that you're his house. And that means that you can't do just whatever you want to do in your house. He's your habitation. He's where you are, where he lives. Come on. And if you don't want to subject him to perversion and pollution, you can't do it in your body because you're subjecting the Holy Spirit. He says, what concord does Christ have with Belial? And he says, what agreement has the temple of God with idols? For you are the temple of the living God. You are the temple. We don't even agree with that. So we can smoke, we can drink, we can fornicate, we can commit adultery, we can do lewd acts. Isn't it amazing? You know, growing up as a little girl, growing up, we hallowed the things of the church. That mean we didn't, you know, people didn't come on the parking lot smoking. We didn't curse. We had a weird kind of way of honoring God, but there were certain things we wouldn't do near the church. If we drove by the church, we turned our radios down. We made sure we didn't, because we had sanctified and hallowed the church building and its grounds. It was like if you sweared on the church, you were going to get a whipping. If they heard you curse, you were going to get back-ended. Come on. There were just certain things we didn't do at the church. But we didn't realize that the building was not the church, that we are the church. Now, outside of the building and outside the grounds, folk was smoking, cursing, all kinds of things we did. You know, it was almost amazing that you know, you could come from the club that night, had to go to church that next morning. You had to go. It wasn't an option. Had to go to church, and when they passed the communion plate, you just kept letting it pass because they told you if you did it unworthily, you were going to hell. We didn't really understand that was unworthiness, was a belief system. It wasn't really what we did. It was what we believed, and what we believe, come on, regulated how we act. We were trying to act right with an unrighteous mind. We were trying to do right without the right belief system. We had agreed that it was not possible to live for God without sinning. We had agreed that nothing in us was good, so we would act bad all week, and then on Sundays we would act good, thinking that was going to get us somewhere. See, we agreed with faulty theology and religious patterns and tradition, and then it took all of this breaking and all of this bondage for God to get us into the mindset that we are righteous, that all of our works are as filthy rags. But it's not because of our righteousness, it is his righteousness. And he says, you are the temple of the living God. And God has said, I will dwell in you and walk in you, and I will be your God, and you will be my people. Wow. The Bible says he's going, shalavada. He's going to live in us, dwell in us. He's going to walk with us. He's going to walk with us. He's going to be my God, and I am going to be his child. We sing, back in the Baptist church, the preachers say, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me that I am his own. And the joy that we share cannot be compared. There is no other, none like him. And when you know, well, I don't know if God is walking with me because I don't really feel like that he's walking with me. I don't feel it. You got to practice. You got to practice and understand that God, and you have to come into agreement that I am the temple of the Holy Ghost. You know what I say? And some of you might not understand why I say this, and I'm through. Might not understand why I say this. I say I'm one of God's favorites. I'm one of God's favorites. Why? Because I had to break a belief system. I had to break a belief system so I wouldn't become an orphan. Are you hearing me? So I had to break a belief system. My dad died, when I was young. And I had to break a belief system that I was fatherless. And I had to say, I'm one of his favorites. I know what the Bible says. He's no respecter of persons, but I just believe in my spirit. You can't take that from me. I believe that. I come in agreement that he's my Abba. He's my father, and he's taking good care of me, and there is no lack in my life. And that's based on my belief system. Now, you can believe because you didn't have a daddy and you didn't grow up with a daddy that you got all these issues and you got all these problems, and it gives you permission to be sloppy agape with the grace of God, and you can believe that, or you can change your position and your posture and your perception and say, he's my Abba, he's my father, he'll never leave me, he'll never forsake me, he'll never walk out on me, he'll never miss a birthday, he'll never miss a game, he'll be with me always. What am I doing? I'm coming into agreement that he's my Abba, and everything I expect a natural Abba to do, a father to do, I expect it out of my father, my Heavenly Father. He's there with me. He says, I'll walk with you. So every ball game, he's there. Come on. At the wedding, he's there. At the birth of a child, he's there. My father is there. And you're not moving on a faulty system that you're missing something because your natural father is not here. What are you saying? I come in agreement with that. Now look at verse 17. He said, therefore come out from among them. From who? From who? Unbelievers. From who? Those who have agreed with the enemy. Even those who said they're in the body of Christ. He says, come out from among them. From them that don't believe that God can walk with us, talk with us, that he can call us our his own. He says, come out from among them and be ye what? Separate. He didn't say isolated. He said, be ye separate, unique. You're a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people. You're unique. You can't walk with everybody. You can't be in the crowd. Oh, God, why am I going this way? And he says, touch, here it goes. Don't touch the unclean thing, and I will receive you. And I will be a father to you, and you will be my sons and daughters, said the Lord. Let's go to Psalms 24 and I'm through. The Lord is amazing. And he walks with me and he talks with me. And he tells me that I am his own. See, sometimes you got to sing to yourself, because when the enemy tries to supplant that lie, that lie that you're not going to make it, that lie that nobody loves you, no, that lie that family can't, no, that, whatever that lie is, you got to get rid of the lie. Look at Psalms 24. He said, the earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof, they, the world and they that dwell in. For he hath founded upon the seas and establishes upon the floods. Who shall ascend to the hill of the Lord? Who shall stand in his holy place? He that have what? Clean hands. Where you have not committed an agreement and a pact with the enemy with your hands. I don't know why, Holy Ghost, you've taken us to hands. Some of you can never make money until your hands are clean. You've made an agreement with your hand. You know, growing up, and I'm being real transparent, growing up, people would go down to certain places. I'm not going to call the place. Go to certain places, and because they wanted to win money, they would go get rabbit's foot, and they would get oil. You know, they would go to a lady, and they would get oil, and she would tell them to rub the oil on their hands and rub the oil, put the oil in their shoes, and when they went to gamble, they would win. What did they do? They polluted and perverted. And what did she do? She took the anointing for them to make money. Now, you got to go pay money to make money. Faulty systems. They agreed with the lie. And even when they came into Christendom, until they break that agreement, some of y'all laughing because some of y'all did it. Some of y'all still doing it. Reading your horoscope to see if you're going to win. Trying to get numbers out of a fortune cookie and play them on the lottery. Come on, people of God. Go ahead and laugh. He that had clean hands and a pure heart have not lifted up his soul to vanity nor sworn deceitfully. He shall receive a blessing from the Lord. Remember the things I told you. Be impeccable with your words. What do you got to do? You've got to renounce that agreement. You've got to get rid of that agreement. How do you do that? You know, I'm going to be impeccable with my words, but I'm going to look at my life and see where I made of agreement, where I have no forward progress, where it feel like I'm spinning my wheels. I'm going to go back and I'm going to see where I made of agreement. Did I make an agreement with my eyes? Did I make an agreement with my mouth? Did I make agreement with my hands? Did I make an agreement in my heart? Glory to God. Glory to God. Now, you've got to move into that place. You got to pull that agreement out, and you've got to start looking at yourself in the Word of God and say, do I really believe that the Word can heal me? He said, the Scripture says He sent His Word and healed them. He sent His Word and healed them. Do you really believe that? The Bible says that death and life is in the power of your tongue. If you believe that, then why are you still speaking death? If you really believe that He gives you power to get wealth, the word power is dunamis, where we can get the word a creative ability. He gives you the ability to create wealth. Why are you sitting there and saying, I'm just waiting on God. I'm waiting on God to bless me. I paid a tithe. I gave an offering. I gave something in Rosh Hashanah or Rosh Hashanah or something they call that New Year, and I'm waiting on my harvest. Now, I grew up on the farm. Now, you know, if you sow a seed, that ain't the end of it. Sowing a seed, you can't just throw the seed out there and expect it to come up without getting the weeds out of there. You got to get the weeds out of there. And once you get the harvest up, then you got to go get it. So see, we've taught a faulty doctrine where you just throw money in a bucket or give and you think it's going to be automatic. No, God's going to open opportunities. He's going to give you opportunities and chances to create wealth. I mean, you say, my marriage is just, I don't even know. See, you're cursing and coming into agreement. You believe the lie, and now He has the authority. He takes the authority over that situation and keeps you in bondage. Hallelujah. Come out of that. Look at your life. Do some homework for me. Look at your life. See where you've come into agreement with the enemy. Ask the Holy Spirit to help you. Ask the Holy Spirit to show you. And then you go on a consecrated fast with the Word of God. With the Word of God. Then I'm not going to read anything. It's going to be my main appetite. And I'm going to find out what the Word of the Lord says. What the Word of the Lord says about my situation. And I'm going to confess that until I come into total agreement with that. And you're going to watch the power. And the Bible says He'll give you a blessing when you come into agreement with Him. Can you give God praise for that word? Come on, come on, come on. I kind of jumped around. But God is going to show you how to move in this next season. Come come out of agreement, come on, without making vows and all kinds of things. And then we're going to start teaching on how to break those inner vows, how to break those things that come against you. First, you've got to come out of agreement. You've got to come out of agreement because the enemy used agreement and he used authority. He used authority. So he gets you, he lies to you so you can agree with him. Then he takes your authority and he causes you to be in bondage. But we break that by the power of the word of God. The Bible says the word is sharper than any two-edged sword, cutting asunder the joint and the marrow. And guess what? The enemy is going to be, that thing is going to be severed in Jesus' mighty name. Come on, Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your permeating power of your word that will give us the light and the glory to go into this next dimension. We thank you that you are freeing us from any agreement, any covenants we made. We renounce them. Come on, we remit them in the name of Jesus. We reverse them and we negate any power and any residue from them. We decree a divine releasing in Jesus' mighty name. Amen, amen. Can you shout glory? Come on, come on, come on. I'm breaking the power of agreement over my life. And when I break that agreement, that enemy has to leave. Amen, amen, amen. You can't break that agreement unless you know that Jesus is Lord of your life. Hallelujah. How do I do that? He says, if you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart, you shall be saved. Saved from what? Damnation. Saved from what? Eternal damnation. Saved from what? Saved from the enemy's tactics. When you come in total agreement with the Father that what he did in his son called Yeshua was for you and for the generations after you, then you're in the kingdom of his dear son. Come on, I want you to repeat this prayer after me. Father, I come to you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I believe he died. He rose. He ascended on my behalf. I ask you to forgive me of my sins. Wash me. Cleanse me. Baptize me with your Holy Spirit. And I'll forever give you glory. I make him Lord of my life for the rest of my life. In Jesus' name. Woo! If you just prayed that prayer with us, I want you to call the number on the screen. 1-866-579-5807. Ministry partners are standing by to take that call. Amen. Can y'all give God praise for those who gave their heart for the Lord? Come on, clap your hands right where you are. Come on, lift your hand and say thank you that we are populating heaven. Say we are populating heaven in Jesus' mighty name. Hey, literally hundreds of you, and it keeps blowing my mind how many people are calling in and say they want to be a part of our church. They want to become members. You can do that. Now, that's only if you don't have a church. That's if you don't have a church. I'm not talking about leaving your church. You're going to be faithful to your church. Stay faithful to tithe where you have your membership. But those that have no church, we would love for you to be a part of our tribe. We had people to drive in to meet us. And it's just been phenomenal. You can call that number on the screen, 1-866-579-5807. They're going to take your call, help you navigate how to become a part of our tribe, our family. I am so honored for all of you to be a part. Now, glory to God. Y'all give God praise for those who gave their hearts and those who became a member. Now, it's time to give. Wow, we're right here, Rosh Hashanah. We're right here, not Rosh Hashanah. We're right here in the 10 days. We're in the days of awe. We're right up on Yom Kippur. We're going to be fasting for 24 hours, praying. We want you to get in. It's the high holy day, and I want you to get it in. You know, giving is the greatest act of acknowledgement. Recently, the Lord told me, he said, Sharon, just acknowledge me more. And I had to repent because I hadn't been acknowledging him the way that I should have. And giving is one of the acts of acknowledgement. You can tell by your giving how much you acknowledge God. Any gift that you bring to a king reveals the value and the worth you put on a king. The value and the worth you put on a king. Now, between 30 to 50%, whenever he tells me the 30 or the 50 I give is what I'm giving out of my giving as a tithe, because that's what the Lord told me. And I'm telling you, my life is tremendously blessed. It's amazing. And, you know, remember, giving is a worship, and worship demands a gift. You never go before a king without a gift. I don't care where you are, what country you are. You don't even go before Queen Elizabeth without a gift. And that means we never come before God without a gift. We want to stand in his holy place with this gift. He says, honor me with the first of your fruit. Honor me with your first fruit. Honor me. Honor me. He says, honor me by giving the first part. Tithe means the first, not just 10. It means the first part. I pay God. I sow into God what is due him before I do anything else. That's a level of honor. And giving also provokes a king to give you something back greater than you gave. When you look at Solomon, the Bible says that he gave. You look at David, he gave. Why? He was always provoked to give something greater. We're going to give you that opportunity now to give and to sow your tithe, and that you can give an offering. Remember, you don't get blessed off of the tithe. The tithe is the tax for living on the earth. That's what I say. And the offering is what we sow. That's what we get blessed off. So it's time to sow your tithe and your offering. You can do that several primary ways. You can go to Dominion World Outreach, Marion, Arkansas, on Giblify. There are several Dominions there, but go to Dominion World Outreach. Dominion World Outreach in Marion, Arkansas. You can give there. You can call the number on the screen, 1-866-579-5807. You can go to dominionworld.org on the web, dominionworld.org. And then you can go to Cash App, $ Dr. Sharon Nesbitt. Now, there is a $ Sharon Nesbitt, but there is a $ Dr. Sharon Nesbitt. That's the real one. You can sow there. And then for you who want to mail your payments in, P.O. Box 41, Marion, Arkansas. That's P.O. Box 41, Marion, Arkansas, 72364. Let's go to the throne of God and ask God to bless what we've already sown. Father, we thank you even now for those who have given. Father, we thank you that those who have sowed their tithe, their offering, and given their first fruit, we thank you that the blessing of the tithe and offering is upon them as they lay them at the feet of our high priest Jesus, where in heaven he receives them there. We thank you even now that the blessing will overtake them and overshadow them, create opportunities for them to become wealthy in Jesus' mighty name. If you believe that, shout, I'm abundantly supplied three times. I'm abundantly supplied. I'm abundantly supplied. I'm abundantly supplied in Jesus' name. You know what? If you get everybody in your house saying that every day, all day, watch how you partner and agree with abundance, and abundance start taking place in your house. Lack has no other choice but to get out of there, because you come out of agreement with lack and barely getting along and living from paycheck to paycheck. It starts with your mouth. Starts with your mouth. Drops in your heart. Then it starts manifesting for you. Come on, shout it again. I'm abundantly supplied. I'm abundantly supplied. I'm abundantly supplied in Jesus' mighty name. Everybody connected to me says we live in prophetic Goshen. That may mean it's dark in Egypt, but we live in Goshen. Goshen, in Jesus' mighty name. Glory to God. Well, clap your hands. The Lord is faithful. We are breaking that power of agreement. Amen. I'll be up praying in the morning at 5:30. Come on in. Watch us. We're praying. Come on. We'll be right back here at 7 o'clock on Wednesdays and at 8:30 on Sundays. This has been Walking in Dominion. Take your authority back.